unprecedented but fitting, 24 JDK enhancement proposals have made it into the JDK 24 codebase. Way too many to cover in one newscast. How dare them not considering this YouTube show when picking jabs? Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Palok, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to go over the first half of the changes JDK 24 brings to Java. Specifically, we're going to look at language and API changes. Next week, it'll be performance improvements and deprecations slash removals. Ready? Then let's dive right in.
The JEP 485 is about adding a new feature to the Stream API called the Gatherer API. It gives you three elements: an interface, a method on the stream interface that takes a gatherer as a parameter, and a factory class called gatherers with pre-made gatherers. Imagine that you need to implement a distinct-like behavior, but with your own way to compare objects for equality, like comparing strings of characters, ignoring case differences. You can map your strings to lowercase, store them in a hash set within your gatherer, and if they are not already in this hash set, push the original element to the downstream. A gatherer works on four elements: a mutable state, an integrator, a finisher, and a combiner. They can be integrated in parallel streams, even if they do not themselves support parallelism.
Another API that got finalized in JDK 24 is for reading and manipulating bytecode. While few developers do that directly, most projects do it indirectly, and a lot, whether to analyze code and dependencies, inject aspects of performance counters, generate proxies, or avoid reflection runtime, there are plenty of ways to employ bytecode manipulation for the greater good. The issue is that this requires libraries like ASM that understand Java's bytecode. And since that can evolve from release to release, we end up in a situation where releases of those libraries don't work with JDK versions that were released later. This is a big contributor to the need to upgrade dependencies when upgrading the JDK, which isn't the end of the world, but it's not great either. By adding an API to read and manipulate bytecode to the JDK, all the use cases I just mentioned can code against that, which makes them much more robust against breakage from JDK upgrades. With this API finalized in JDK 24, with a bunch of changes over its second preview in JDK 23, by the way, I recommend that all projects that work with bytecode develop a plan how to switch to this new API in the future to help their users more freely choose the JDK version they're running on. That could be done by baselining against JDK 24 later, a proposition that works particularly well for projects that adopted a tip-and-tail release model, or by shipping a multi-release jar that uses the new API on new JDKs. JDK 24 includes three cryptographic JEPs, and I'm not going to stand here and pretend that I understand them very well. Encryption is already complex enough, and it doesn't help that two of those three JEPs throw in quantum computing and some kind of modular salad.
Lettuce.
Come January, Anna will go through these changes in a dedicated Inside Java newscast. For this video, I'll stick to the high level. To prepare for a future where quantum computers could break encryption algorithms like RSA and Diffie-Hellman, Java is adopting quantum-resistant alternatives. These module lattice-based algorithms were standardized by the US National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, and JDK 24 enables them for key encapsulation and digital signatures by making them available through the Key Factory, Key Pair Generator, Chem, and Signature APIs. The new algorithm family is called ML-Chem and ML-DSA respectively, and using it follows the regular API flow. The two JEPs are final in JDK 24, which already brings us to the end of the list of finalized features for this episode. You have a choice to make now. You can keep watching for an update on all the language and API previews shipping with JDK 24, or you can subscribe for next week's newscast, where I'll go over half a dozen performance-rated features that JDK 24 comes with. Sorry,
what's that? What?
Oh, I'm just now being informed that you can also do both. Crazy times.
Dogs and cats living together.
The third cryptographic JEP first previews an API for key derivation functions, KDFs. KDFs follow JDK 21's key encapsulation mechanism as a second step towards hybrid public key encryption, which enables the smooth transition to quantum-safe encryption algorithms. KDFs, and let me read from the JEP here, make use of cryptographic inputs, such as initial key material, a salt value, and a pseudorandom function, to create new cryptographically strong key material. A KDF is often used to create cryptographic data from which multiple keys can be obtained. A KDF allows keys to be created in a manner that is both secure and reproducible by two parties sharing knowledge of the inputs. The KDF API splits into two parts. First, creating a KDF initialized with specific parameters, and second, deriving keys and data from those parameters, as well as from provided key material and other optional inputs. If you have any questions about this, please don't put them in the comments. I'm already way off my depth here. More details await you in Anna's newscast in January.
Structured concurrency is still in the same state as in the JDK 23. The JEB 499 brings no change to continue getting feedback on the current state of the API. That being said, you can also check the early access version of the Loom project to get a glimpse at what could come and also provide feedback on it. In this early access version, you can create instances of the structured task scope class using an off factory method that can take a join object as a parameter or a config object to configure the virtual threads this structured task scope can create. You can use the different implementations of the joiner interface the API gives you or implement your own. Among other things, the scope object can give the results of the task you submitted in a stream. You can produce your final result from that stream, or you can interrupt it if you're happy with what you already have, which is very handy. The JEP 487 is about scope value. It is a preview feature with no change compared to the JDK 23 to get more feedback from the community. Scope values may be seen as some kind of replacement for thread local variables, as they solve the same problem, being able to pass values to methods without using their parameters. A scope value variable can be bound to a value. This binding exists within the context of a method call. That being said, scope values can be shared between threads, as long as this thread has a period of execution that is bound to this method call. This is the case for threads created by structured task scope, but not for threads created using new, because scope values can be shared among threads. They should be non-modifiable. But you can still rebind a given scope value if this is what you need.
The vector API is still incubating, still waiting for Valhalla, nothing changed, nothing to see. Let's move on to language changes. Since the introduction of type and record patterns, Java gained capabilities for reference types that aren't equally present for primitive types. For example, having a case int I in a switch didn't use to compile, and neither did an instance of int. It also wasn't possible to switch over Boolean, float, double, or long values. JDK 24 previews fixes for all of that. But those mostly just improves the uniformity of the language, I want to point out one specific addition that will significantly improve code that needs it, and that's primitive conversion. Say you have a long L and want to find out whether it fits into an int. You could do that with a range check or with this preview feature with an L instance of int I. Not quite a game changer, but now imagine you want to find out whether that L losslessly fits into a float. Now it's suddenly no longer just a simple range check, but L instance of float F, still very simple. These conversion checks also give meaning to a wider use of primitives in record patterns. If your record has a long component and you write a record pattern, you had to use type long for that component. With this change, you could, for example, use int, and the pattern would only match if the number can be losslessly represented as an int. Primitive patterns are in their second preview and unchanged over their first preview in JDK 23. This one is straightforward. Constructor buddies can now contain a so-called prologue, code before an explicit call to another constructor with this or super. This can be almost arbitrary code. The only exception is that it cannot use the instance under construction except to initialize fields that do not have their own initializers. Flexible constructor buddies allow for easier validation, preparation, and sharing of arguments before passing them on to another constructor, which comes in particularly handy when chaining record constructors, as all but the canonical one are forbidden from assigning fields themselves and must forward to the canonical constructor. Somewhat surprisingly, this feature also became important for Project Valhalla and its exploration of null-restricted types, but no time to dwell on that here. Brian's recent Valhalla update has more details on that. Flexible constructor bodies are in their third preview and are unchanged over the last one in JDK 23. In most circumstances, most Java developers prefer the precision and clarity of single-type imports. But not only are there some devs who generally prefer star imports,
some men just want to watch the world burn.
There are also situations where star imports downsides barely matter and the ease of use reigns supreme. Experiments, demos, scripts, early learning are some of them. Module imports are a smarter and more powerful mechanism to mass import types. With an import module module name, developers can import a module's full public API. That's smarter because unlike a star import of a single package, this isn't just a slice of an API, and it's more powerful because it imports more. And a source file that starts with, say, import module Java SQL and import module Java XML couldn't communicate more clearly what the code is dealing with. Module imports are in their second preview with two small changes. First, modules can now require transitive Java base, which apparently they couldn't before. This feels like something I should know but didn't. This allows Java SE to require transitive Java base, which in turn means that an import module Java SE will make the entire Java SE API available, which is super neat. Star imports, second by the way, star imports are now considered more specific than module imports, which means the former can shadow the latter. So if you import modules that have conflicting simple type names like Java utilist from Java base and Java awtlist from Java desktop, a star import like import Java util asterisk can specify which one you intend to import, just like you could already do with a single type import Java utilist. I would not recommend mixing module and star imports like that, but nonetheless the hierarchy module star single type getting more specific makes sense. Speaking of recommendations, I see no reason not to generally prefer module imports over star imports. In fact, I struggle to see any reason to use star imports once this feature is standardized. Here's another feature that targets learners, scripters, explorers, and demonstrators. If you don't intend to write a larger program, the classic public static void main string bracket bracket args inside a whole class is a lot of overhead, syntactically, but also just by how many concepts are referenced, classic, static, visibility, parameter lists, etc. Why not get rid of all of that and allow simple void main? You can even omit the surrounding class, and for such simple source files, you get an import module Java base for free, so you can dive right in with collections, IO, math, date and time, and more. Simple source files and instance main methods are in their fourth preview and unchanged over the last one in JDK 23. JDK 24 also ships with a bunch of performance-related improvements. Project Leiden ships its first feature, namely ahead of time class loading and linking. Virtual threads now synchronize without pinning. The garbage collectors Shenandoah and ZGC further embrace their generational hypothesis, and G1 got a late barrier expansion. We get experimental compact object headers, and full JDK runtime images can be a bit smaller. But more details on all of that in the next Inside Java newscast next week. I'll see you then. So long!